With angular momentum and spin, we have studied some very general aspects of quantum mechanical systems in three spatial dimensions. And we have seen that they're interesting in their own right. But we encountered angular momentum in the first instance when we considered central potentials, as it solves two-thirds of the problem. In spherical coordinates, it takes care of the angular dependence on theta and phi, and only leaves the radial Schrödinger equation in R. So we finally turn to solve this radial equation for a concrete example. This is the hydrogen atom, hence a very specific real-world system. And along with the harmonic oscillator, whose range of applications includes photons, and spin, which is an intrinsic property of fundamental particles, this certainly competes for the status of the most important example in this whole course. Indeed, the hydrogen atom was central for the development of quantum mechanics, and what one learns from it has wide implications. This really provides the foundations for entire subjects and disciplines, including atomic and molecular physics, chemistry and material science, and also reaching into condensed matter physics, astrophysics, and cosmology. Moreover, what we will see is that we can really capture the essence of the hydrogen atom based on all that we have done so far. But there are also some subtle points that we neglect, and under further investigation of the fine details, we would first uncover intricate interactions in a quantum system made of several parts, and then enter relativistic quantum mechanics, and eventually even quantum electrodynamics. And these subtle interactions involve spin, while quantum electrodynamics joins this all up with photons, so this really reaches far. We start with some preparations, which incidentally also give us a glimpse on some aspects to come later in this course. This is due to the fact that in the atom we really deal with two particles, an electron and a proton, where the latter forms the nucleus of the atom. This means that the proton moves much less than the electron, simply because it is much heavier, and our preparations quantify this both in classical as well as in quantum terms. So these two particles have opposite charge and attract each other by the Coulomb interaction. Now the wave function of this composed system really has to be a function of the positions of both particles, as we can measure these independently. Indeed, what we work out from this is a joint probability density that informs us of the outcomes of such joint measurements. For instance, you can infer from this conditional probabilities and correlations, including entanglement, which we will discuss in the last chapter. Here we want to solve the specific problem where the Hamiltonian is composed of the kinetic energies of these particles and the interaction energy. So this tells you all you need to set up such a problem. Now to simplify it, we introduce coordinates that we know serve us well in the classical setting. This is the center of mass, along with the total momentum and the total mass, which classically describes the motion of the atom as a whole. And then we have the relative coordinate and the corresponding momentum, as well as the so-called reduced mass mu. These are exactly the same quantities that we would introduce to, say, study the gravitational two-body problem, which then reduces to the motion of a particle around a mass centered at the origin. Here we simply use this to rewrite the Hamiltonian. That really amounts to rewriting the true Laplace operators, but algebraically it is much simpler. The key observation is that these new objects still have the normal commutation relations between positions and momenta. And then we find that the Hamiltonian indeed becomes the sum of two independent parts. The first one describes the free motion of the center of mass, and the second one describes an effective single particle of reduced mass mu, which moves in three dimensions and is attracted to the origin by the Coulomb potential. So we can use separation of variables to split this into two problems. The free motion is really simple, and the other problem is very well defined and what remains to be solved. It was the purpose of these preparations to really identify this problem in a well-controlled way. I will walk you through the solution. That won't take long, even though it involves yet another class of orthogonal polynomials. And then we spend quite a bit longer on the discussion and see what we can learn from these solutions. So we want to solve the Schrödinger equation for the effective particle of reduced mass mu, and in presence of the Coulomb potential, which is a central potential. We already worked out that we can separate out the angular part associated with angular momentum. We will soon return to this simple picture. So we are left with the radial Schrödinger equation as given here with the explicit form of this potential. To be concrete, I have here already included the quantum numbers, taking care which objects can depend on which number. Note, for instance, that the magnetic quantum number does not enter the radial equation, so its solutions cannot depend on it, and that also applies to the energies. Now, as previously, when encountering such a differential equation, we seek to bring it into a form where the physical solutions are just polynomials. There is, of course, no guarantee that we can do this, but here we indeed again succeed when we factor out an exponential radial dependence with a suitably scaled exponent. And the remainder we call f. We insert this into the Schrödinger equation, where we evaluate derivatives using the chain and product rules, and then read off a simpler differential equation for f. This is known as Kummer's differential equation, again an equation that has been written down a long time ago. In it we combined a whole lot of constants into the symbol n, so the solutions really only depend on n and l, and we can use these as indices to label the solutions. That's now very transparent. At this point, n isn't constrained, but this changes when we follow the steps of the harmonic oscillator and search for solutions in the form of a power series. The picture that then unfolds is exactly the same. If the series does not terminate, we find solutions that we cannot normalize, so we find ourselves restricted to polynomial solutions. These exist when n is an integer larger than l. So while we hadn't constrained n in any way before, this now has indeed changed. The polynomials that we then find are related to another class of well-known orthogonal polynomials, the so-called Laguerre polynomials, as well as their associated variants. Again, I give you generating functions that deliver them all. As a matter of fact, we have now encountered all three of the so-called classical orthogonal polynomials, attached to the names of Hermite, Legendre and Laguerre. So it is probably good to mention that they are all orthogonal in relation to a certain scalar product, resulting in integrals of exactly the kind that we would use to show the orthogonality of the wave functions in our quantum problems. They also show up in many other contexts, for instance in probability, where the Hermite polynomials appear via the link to Gaussians. So this solves the problem, at least for bound states with wave functions that can be normalized, and we can collect our results. The wave functions are indexed by three quantum numbers, with n known as the principal quantum number. The wave function itself then contains a radial dependence with a polynomial multiplied by a decaying exponential and an angular dependence given by one of the spherical harmonics. The radial dependence involves a natural length scale, a naught, which is known as a Bohr radius, and gives you an idea of the size of the atom. By inverting the definition of n, we obtain the energy, which actually only depends on this quantum number, explaining its name as the principal quantum number. All these energies are negative. Again, these are just the bound states. The expressions involve a natural energy scale, which is known as the Rydberg energy. So this fixes the bound state wave functions, which we also call atomic orbitals, and the quantized energy levels of the hydrogen atom. Given the constraints on the quantum numbers, we can also infer that these energy levels have an orbital degeneracy of n squared. As in previous problems, this ignores a possible spin degeneracy. This covers the most important mathematical aspects of the solutions. So we can move on to discuss the physical implications.